Yo, y'all can hit us up on Instagram at @different_perspective_podcast. You know what I'm saying? Definitely check us out on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play. And we now available on Stitcher. First things first, man, I'm mobile today, so y'all gotta excuse the background noise. Listeners, once again, welcome to another episode of A Different Perspective Podcast. A lot going on. We headed into 2018 real fast, you know what I'm saying? We already at episode 12. That's monumental, you know what I'm saying? A few months ago, I was just trying to work the kinks out of this and find a direction, and here we are, you know what I'm saying, episode 12, you know, thanks to y'all, the listeners, you know what I'm saying, for checking in, for supporting, you know what I'm saying, and for enjoying this dope content that I bring. Well, today, once again, I got another legendary guest with me, you know what I'm saying, I got my brother Anton Pukshansky, you know what I'm saying, legendary bass player, keyboard player, and engineer, you know, all around producer. Music man, you know what I'm saying? Very well known, you know what I'm saying, throughout the hip hop industry, but I feel like he needs to be very well known, with you, the listeners, because a lot of the stuff that y'all love, it came from him. So, you know, as usual, I run down a list of he's worked with Eric B and Rakim, Grand Puba, Nas, KRS-One, MC Search, Main Source, Carlos Santana, OC, MobbDeep, Akineli, Kool G Rap, G Love, Killa Priest, Queen Latifah, Mike Geronimo. I mean, I can just keep going on forever with the list. So, what I'm gonna do right now is we're just gonna get into this episode. You know what I'm saying? Anton Pukshansky,
ladies and gentlemen,
legendary.
May I have your attention?
Lucid Network presents A Different Perspective Podcast. You're now tuned in.
I guess as I do with all my guests, you know, I want to go back to the beginning. I want to go back to you coming up in Russia.
Well, you know, came up in Russia as a, you know, a piano nerd, basically. Went to music school from like age six, right up until my family and I left Russia at age 15 in 1979.
Right.
Came straight to New York. Settled in Jackson Heights, Queens.
Right.
As it happens, of course, I didn't know that, but basically right down the street from Dr. Butcher and Rob Swift and Eric B. And, you know, always been into music. Started getting into recording in my teens. Mm-hmm. Had a home studio for a while with a friend. And got a gig at Power Play in 1988, engineering.
So let's take it back to, okay, you said you took piano when you were in Russia.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I did. I'm just trying to build the basis of your musical, you know, where that where that ear that you got and that soul that you got comes from.
So after, you know, after all that piano in Russia, came to the U.S. and picked up the guitar and the bass, because that's what everybody around me was playing. and got really into it. And by learning the bass and listening to all the classic bass lines, got way deep into soul music.
Cool. So that just kind of called out to
me. Yeah. You know, I grew up as a classical kid, and then of course in high school got exposed to all kinds of, you know, mostly rock music. But at some point I realized that everything that I liked about rock music came from the soul side.
Right.
So then I started digging and discovering artists and, you know, picking up bass lines, et cetera, et cetera. And just been a lifelong kind of mission.
Right. So what was there a defining moment, defining song that you heard that made you know, okay, this is, you know, what I want to do as far as the bass playing and stuff like that?
Gotta be either Flashlight by Parliament,
right,
or the first Meters album.
Wow, the Meters.
Yep.
Cool. Yeah, and that would explain a lot of production for you, the Meters.
Well, the first Meters album, actually, the person who turned me on to it was Large Proffesor.
All right. Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, man.
That was your first experience with the Meters.
I mean, I heard 50 Struts before, but...
didn't really know who they were. Or...
Right. Large Proffesor gave me a cassette.
Yeah.
That he made for me.
Right.
With all the things that he thought were the funkiest that I should listen to.
Right.
And the first side of it was the first Meters album, with the Pi-Pi, straight from top to bottom. And that became like my Bible.
Right. Cool. Yeah, we'll get into you and Paul because I know y'all had a great relationship.
Still do.
So we'll build up to that. So, okay. So
right on.
You said that you were, in a band. And
I was in a band, and the guitar player in the band said, hey, we could do our demo for free, but somebody's got to engineer it because I got a friend who owns a studio.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, I've been doing this home studio bit for a while. I'll engineer it. And so we went into the studio. It was kind of janky. Mm-hmm. It was on West 22nd Street. It was called Zounds. And its claim to fame was that Stetsasonic did their demos there.
Okay.
Before I showed up.
All right.
So while I was doing that, the owner offered me a job engineering. And of course I jumped on it. And for the next year, I pretty much lived in the place just about. I mean, the place had a shower and a couch. So like I'd sleep there at least 3-4 nights a week.
Yeah, it became home.
Yeah, because I was just learning.
Yeah.
Now,
what kind of board were you running? Was it like
a... That was a Trident Series 80.
Okay.
And a Atari, you know, 24-track, 2-inch machine.
Wow.
There wasn't a whole lot of outboard. But, like, you know, it's first place I saw an SB-12. This was before the 1200 came out.
Right.
And got pretty handy with that. And then... that place, basically, the owner wasn't good at business.
Mm-hmm.
So that place closed about a year and some months after I started.
Okay.
And I was out of a job, and I opened up the back of the Village Voice, where all the studios advertised.
Right.
And figured I'd just start calling. And the first place I called, because they were listed under AAAA, was PowerPlay.
Right.
So I called up. I knew nothing about it.
Yeah.
Called him up, said, can I speak to the owner? And it was Tony on the phone, and he's like, speaking. So I told him about who I am, and he's like, well, when can you come in?
So Tony said, just answered the phone back then. What year were you talking about?
88.
Okay, all right.
I mean, Tony didn't usually answer the phone.
Right.
He just happened to answer the phone.
Yeah.
So, you know, he asked me some questions and said, when can you come in? I said, I'm available. He said, well, come on down right now. So I jumped on the train and I came down to Long Island City and, you know, Tony walked me around and said, you know, I can't start you as an engineer because you don't know the SSL boards.
Right.
But I'll start you as an assistant and, you know, in a few months you should be engineering.
So a little note, and even back then, and it was that a hard transition going from the Trident to the SSL? Or was
not really. Not really. I mean, you know, a console is a console. I had to learn the automation.
Right.
Because that was real important back then.
Yeah.
And like Tony said, in a couple of months, I was engineering. Wow. And when I walked into Power Play, again, you know, at this point, I'm aware of hip hop.
Right.
But not like a serious fan.
Right, right.
You could not be aware of hip hop living in New York in the 80s.
Exactly.
But I only started paying attention really around 86 because I heard Check Out My Melody on the radio.
Right.
Check out my melody, hand out a cigar. I'm letting knowledge be born, and my name's the R. AKA, I am not like the rest of them. I'm not on the list. That's what I'm saying. I drop
bombs like a scientist. And that was, to me, different than any hip hop I had heard before.
Which it was.
Which it was. Yeah. And it had a whole lot more to do with the soul music that I was digging.
Right, right.
Than just about anything else that was going on at the time.
Right.
And that's when I started paying attention. So 88, I walk into Power Play, and there's three rooms, and one is empty. One's got Eric B. and Rakim working on Follow the Leader. Mm-hmm. And one's got the other one's got KRS working on By Any Means Necessary.
Right.
And I'm like, okay, this is Hip Hop Central. But the first project I did at Power Play wasn't hip hop. It was reggae. It was a Bunny Wailer album. Yeah, one of the original Wailers.
Okay, the first solo album.
It was an album. It came out a couple of years after we actually made it. It was called Just Be Nice.
Okay.
And it was actually
kind of hip hop-ish.
Yes, yeah. Bunny was like in New York trying to absorb this new shit that was happening.
Yeah. That's crazy. So that was
that was my first job, and I ended up playing guitar on it and programming the 1200 because they didn't know what to do with the thing, but they wanted that feel. So that's how I started learning the 1200. And then soon after that, I got put on the Eric B. and Rakim sessions, and this was for Let the Rhythm Hit Him.
Right.
There was actually, I don't know, I think, you know, it's kind of a long time, but I think the sessions for that and the sessions for G Rap's Wanted Dead or Alive were kind of going on at the same time.
Yeah. Now, from what I heard, they had that studio blocked out a long time for that Let the Rhythm Hit Him out.
Oh, months. Like, months and months. By the way, when I got put on the Eric B. and Rakim session was, I'm pretty sure it was like maybe a couple of weeks after Paul C. got killed.
Okay.
And I didn't know. I had no idea.
To meet Paul C.
I never got to meet Paul C., but that day I met Large Proffesor.
Okay. And at this time also, I don't mean to cut you, but at this time there was a friction between Eric B. and Rakim going on.
By the time I got involved, it wasn't even friction. You just would never see them in the same room together.
Okay.
So, you know, Eric would come through sometimes during the day and maybe lay down a loop or do some scratches or whatever. And you'd never see Rakim. Rakim only came in at night, and he would call and make sure that he'd be alone in the studio with just the staff. And he'd come in and, you know, knock out lyrics and be ghost in like an hour.
He'd just come, lay him down, and be gone.
He'd come in, you know, maybe smoke a blunt, shoot the shit, walk in the booth, do, I don't know, maybe two takes, usually just one.
Yeah.
And then be like, all right, I'm out.
That's crazy.
I mean, talk about coming in prepared. You know, no notes, no really anything written, because he had already practiced it and committed it to memory. Yeah.
He just come in and lay it down.
So
he was easy to work with.
Super easy to work with. One of my favorite people in the world. Wouldn't, you know, no bullshit. Serious about his craft. No posse ever. I mean, always alone.
Yeah, I've heard that. Like, I heard about him, that he rolls solo.
Yep, always, which is, you know, completely opposite of literally everyone else at the time.
Yeah. Wow. So I guess, take us through that journey of, you know, working on that project, you and Paul, you and Large P.
So most of the time, it was just me and Paul in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started watching this kid, and I say kid because, you know, Paul was coming into the studio straight from high school.
Right.
come in with like a half a crate of records, and the studio SB1200 would be there waiting for him. And he'd just come in and start digging through his records and working on beats. And here I am, you know, watching and absorbing all this. Mm-hmm. And to me, it was like, immediately, like, was obvious, okay, this is artistry.
Right.
You know, this kid is an artist with this, both with matching up loops and tempos and keys, and with the just the technical ability of getting the most out of the 1200, which is a limiting machine. Right. I mean, we're talking, you know, 10 seconds, 2.5 seconds a pad.
Wow.
In mono. That's right. All you got.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah. So, you know, I started learning just by absorbing what he was doing. And he started learning by absorbing and by asking questions, because Paul's a super curious dude.
Right.
About what I was doing as far as EQ and compression and mixing and panning and, you know, all the elements that go into making a record.
Right.
So we just kind of became a team, and really, you know, both of us young. He was a little, you know, he's a bit younger than me, but both of us were still young and just kind of learning by doing and by absorbing.
So.
And then, you know, we just got tighter and tighter because we both love the same source. We both love the same music.
So. Let me ask you this, because of course, like everybody else, I've heard the interviews and I've heard the stories.
Right.
That basically you guys, especially, you know, Large Proffesor, but that y'all basically, and Large Proffesor basically did that whole album.
That's how I see it. That's literally how I see it. I think there were some tracks that started out as Paul CB.
Mm-hmm.
I can't swear to it. But I think In the Ghetto started out as a Paul CB.
Okay. So how often was Eric B coming? Not often.
You know, maybe once a week. So, you know, it was all different. Some weeks he'd be there every day.
Yeah.
And then some weeks he wouldn't be there at all. Okay. And everything in between. That's, you know, the album took a long time because nobody was, except for Paul and I, nobody was really focused.
Right. That's crazy. So... What was the process with you guys? Like, how did y'all, you know?
Well, Paul started asking me about keys because he was matching up samples and matching up loops. And he started asking me, like, would these two keys go together? And I would listen, and because of my, you know, 8 years of ear training, I'd, you know, give him advice on which way to go, you know, speed up or slow down, etc. Because you couldn't change pitch without changing speed back then.
Right.
So it took a lot of like, you know, speeding one sample up and slowing another one down so that they'd meet somewhere in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the same.
You know, stuff that we don't have to do anymore.
Right. So I also heard that in that studio you came across, well, was that the first studio you worked in where you came across that very first sampler that was made?
Oh, the Puba song. That was a power play.
Oh, that
it's
was
not
a power
first
play.
Yeah, it's not the first sampler. It was the first sampler that you could sample 20 seconds in stereo and then trigger it with a sound like a hi-hat or a snare.
Ah, okay.
And that was tricky because you had to get it just right for it to loop. It was a lot of work, and there's no screen, you know, there's no screen or anything. You're just kind of truncating blind.
So back onto that Let the Rhythm Hit Him album, what were you mainly using, the SP-12 or the S-950?
No, there was no S-950s at that time. Okay. Not even the 900, I don't think. It was just SP-12 and the Publison. You know, I'd say like 90% SP-1200 and 10% Publison.
Okay, cool. So how did that lead into, meanwhile, while y'all working on that, then that led into Kool G Rap was next, right?
Yep. And it was kind of like I said, the way I remember it, it was kind of at the same time.
Okay.
A lot of times, you know, Eric wouldn't come in for a week, and G-Rap, because Eric was technically executive producer on the G-Rap record.
Right.
So, you know, G-Rap would come in, and we'd work on a track or two for him. And also, you know, sometimes Paul was already thinking about Main Source, so he was working on beats for the Main Source album already.
For Breaking Atoms.
Yeah.
At that time. Okay. Wow, that's crazy. So how were some of those G-Rap sessions? I mean, like, I just want to get around to everything, but
yeah,
you
know, but
it's,
I know,
it's kind of overwhelming.
I know, and I only got like half an hour or two. Right. So G-Rap, so I love G-Rap. Mm-hmm. Okay, G-Rap is one of the most real people on the planet. But G-Rap, I mean, G-Rap was mostly focused on the lyrics, as you could tell by listening to the record.
Right.
You know, he kind of trusted Paul to pick the beats. And, you know, he might have some ideas here and there, but like I said, he was mainly focused on
just on his lyrics.
Getting the lyrics done and spitting them right.
Okay.
And, you know, at the speed that he spits, it's a lot of work.
Right, right.
Paul, you know, was getting, like literally in front of my eyes, was getting more and more creative. That's how Streets of New York came about.
That's what I was about to ask about.
There we go. So Streets of New York, Paul comes in with a drum, you know, a drum pattern, mm-hmm. and that one guitar sample. But there's no bass. It sounds kind of empty. Paul spends, you know, maybe a day looking for samples to fit and doesn't find anything, at which point I said, well, look, you know, I can lay down a bass line.
Mm-hmm.
We actually laid down the bass line on this Korg M1, the keyboard that we had in the studio. And then I just started messing around and with the piano pattern, and Paul was like, that sounds really good. Lay it down. So I lay down the piano pattern, and then we sitting there listening to the lyrics, and I'm like, blind man plays the sax. Well, I got a sax sample on this keyboard. So I did this like little lick right after he says that, just to sort of
accent it. Yeah.
And then Paul's like, keep going. And that's how we end up with a 45-second sax solo, fake sax solo at the end.
That's how it is in the streets of New York.
Time I don't think a lot of people thought it was a real sax.
You know, it was the first, the Korg M1 was the first keyboard that had a sax sound that was worth a damn.
Yeah, that was a realistic patch, man.
Yep.
That was a realistic patch.
And you also have to play it like a sax player.
Yeah,
you can't play it like, if you play it like a piano player, no matter what sound you're using, it's still going to sound odd.
Yeah.
So I was like trying to think like a horn player.
All right. Well, you pulled that one off, man.
Thank you.
I right there.
Every time I see the video and I see dude in the windowsill playing the sax, I crack up.
Right. That's you. That's crazy. So okay. So let's skip from the G-Rap sessions now to the Breaking Atom sessions.
So pretty much, you know, shortly after we finished with G-Rap and Eric, Paul got the deal with Wild Pitch, and we went in to really finish the album.
Mm-hmm.
He'd already had a lot of tracks done. He had Roger do his thing complete already.
Okay. Oh, so that one was done.
That one was done.
On the scene.
And all the other tracks were kind of in the early stages of production.
Okay.
And again, then this is like all of a sudden, you know, it's still me and Paul in the studio most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's really focused because, you know, there's a budget, there's, you know, money being spent, and Paul's not like Eric. He actually, you know, he didn't have a crazy budget. He was like, we got to get this done in a reasonable amount of time.
Right.
So that's when things got really focused, and we'd be spending, you know, 12, 14-hour days in the studio polishing these tracks and adding things. At some point, Paul bought a Rhodes, which we brought into the studio. I always had my bass and guitar on hand because mm-hmm. you never know when Paul says this needs something. And that's, you know, that's how that album came together. So and what, then, you know,
what about, yeah, go ahead. Looking out the front door?
That one was an early one. He had that one almost done.
Okay.
And I didn't do a whole lot on that particular track other than, you know, record and mix it.
Okay.
It's when we got into, like, Snake Eyes and a bunch of other tracks that, you know, that almost from scratch.
So it comes just simple. I see people rolling dice with lies, telling lies and cutting posts like knives for a sandwich and shelter, for proper shelter, clothes on a man's back for fame and wealth.
So we move from there to let's talk about, you know, the first time. Let's talk about the session with Live at the Barbecue.
All right, so that was actually at the very end.
Okay.
That was we basically had the album done.
Mm-hmm.
And Paul wanted a posse cut. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were all hanging out, all everybody on the posse, everybody involved, and a bunch of other people. We got started really late. Mm-hmm. Everybody spent a lot of time writing. And then by the time everybody was ready to go, it was like, I don't know, 1, 2 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And it was 1, 2, 3, 4. Everybody knocked their stuff out. Fatal had a little bit of a struggle,
mm-hmm.
but everybody just kind of came together and gathered around him and gave him confidence. And that, you know, that helped him knock it out.
Okay.
Well, and then, you know, about 6 in the morning, we were done, and everyone in the room knew that something special just went down.
Yeah, because you know that question, it was about Nas. That was a loaded question. That was like, did you hear something special from him then, or was at that time, was he just another rapper to you?
Nas was not just another rapper, because Nas has been hanging around the studio for like about a year by then.
Okay.
And
so he
Paul
was hanging
actually,
around through all of the Eric and Rock sessions and everything.
Yep. Being real quiet and kind of shy, sitting in the corner writing.
I know this some early shit. This is 1991 shit. I was 16 years old, nigga. It's like dead jaw, dead jaw, dead jaw, dead jaw, dead jaw, dead jaw. Yo, yeah, that's all.
It goes streets disciple. My rap's a trifle. I shoot slugs from my brain just like a rifle. Stampede the stage. I leave the microphone split. Play Mr. Tuffy while I'm on some pretty tone shit. Verbal assassin. Architecture pleases. When I was 12, I went to hell for loving Jesus. Nasty Nas is a rebel. America. Police murderer. Causing hysteria. My troops rolled up with a strange force. I was trapped in a cage and lit out by the main source. Swimming in women like a lifeguard. Put on a bulletproof, nigga, I strike hard. Kidnapped the president's wife.
Without a plan.
And hanging like the Ku Klux Klan. I melt mics till the sound waves over. Before stepping in the media, I'd rather step to jaw. Slamming MCs on submit. Cause verbally, I'm iller than an AIDS patient. I move swift and uplift your mind. Shoot the gift
when I riff and rhyme.
A rapping sniper, speaking real words. Thoughts react like Steven Spielberg. Poetry attack, paragraphs
punch hard.
My brain is insane.
Out to lunch, girl.
Science is drunk, my raps are toxic. 1991 hip hop shit. It's like that, y'all.
That's all.
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 That's
before that, Paul and I did Nas's first demo. We did a 3-song demo.
I heard about that demo.
And somewhere in my garage is a DAT tape with that demo.
Wow.
But I've been sworn to never play it.
I think somebody leaked some of it. I don't know if it was the same songs, but there was supposedly a leak of the demo.
You know, I never really like went and researched it,
yeah.
But I'm not surprised. There were a lot of people coming in and out of Power Play.
Yeah, that's crazy. I mean, it's just, so let me ask you this. We're going to pause just for a second.
Yeah.
Just what we've covered now, just covering, you came in the door with Bunny Wailer, you moved from that to Eric B and Rakim, who was basically the biggest rap group at that time.
Pretty much. Well, and I also somehow in between all those, I also ended up working with KRS a bunch.
Right.
So, mostly because KRS, you know, KRS had so many projects going.
Yeah.
And his engineer, D Square, just couldn't be there for all of it.
All of it, right.
So I was kind of like the relief pitcher. Not, and I wasn't the only one. There were a bunch of us. But I ended up working with Chris on Blueprint of Hip Hop, and then on Edutainment and the Heel.
I didn't realize you worked on Edutainment and all that, yep. Too. That's what's up.
And also the Heel Project. Like I said, Chris was going in every direction at the time.
Right.
He was in the studio literally every day.
That's crazy. So, it's like I said, I mean, as far as Chris and as far as, you know, Rakim, it was already established that they were, you know, some of the, they were two of the best, basically. And
I pretty much started. G-Rap,
yeah, you started at the top. You know what I'm saying? So, but, I guess that defeats my question, because what I was about to ask you was, did you realize what the stuff that you was working on was going to impact the world like it did? But I guess.
No, I didn't.
I guess, well, instead of talk about Rakim or KRS, like when y'all started on Breaking Atoms, I'm sure you recognized something special in Large Proffesor when you first met him, and as well as he realized something special about you, you know what I'm saying? But did you realize the stuff that y'all would create would impact the world like that? Like,
No. I mean, I knew it was special, but I had no idea the kind of impact that it would last like that. Only later did it become obvious. At the time, it was just like work, you know? It was exciting, but it wasn't like we're making history.
Right. And through those relationships, so after Breaking Atoms, like you said, you went on to work. Then you wound up doing the work with Fudge Pudge.
Organized,
right. And so,
and that was a really special session. That one I actually knew was going to be a special session because those cats were so creative from jump.
No doubt.
I mean, it was obvious they were like, they weren't afraid to break rules because, as far as they were concerned, there weren't any rules.
Yeah. I had the pleasure of hanging out with them guys a few times. I was actually on the set when they did, they were in St. Albans Park and they shot some parts for Who Ate My Last Piece of Chicken.
Nice.
Yeah, I was there. So, you know, that was pretty cool.
That is super cool. Yeah, and those guys, you know, their ears were so open that, I felt I could, you know, say anything and not be shut down. And that went not just for me, but for everyone.
Right.
Where are we going from here?
That's Punch came about because I was sitting around in the library throwing the pants, just messing around.
With a funky intro, people approach me knowing I'm the Prince Pro. ETR by guess, and I'm the first batter. The Pharaoh usually go first, but it don't matter. Funky slices of beats like this comes once in a blue, but it's not hard for me to chew. So kick off the shoes and don't forget.
And I think it was Larry, I think it was Prince Poe who came in and said, "What's that?" I'm like, nothing yet. Yeah. He's like, well, I'm making something, man.
Yeah, you just fucking around.
Yep, and there's Fudge Funk.
Let the beat ride.
And
let
Anton.
The ride. Let the beat ride.
I think you had kind of a lot more input on their album than the others.
I think probably that one I had maybe the most input.
Yeah.
Again, because they were so open.
Right, right.
You know, like Walk Into the Sun, they had this one part. They had the Earth, Wind, and Fire loop.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no change. And I was like, can I try to bring a change in? And they're like, yeah, go.
Mm-hmm.
And I brought in the Steely Dan Green Earrings sample.
Right, right.
And they're two different keys, but the keys are related. So it works.
Blank, yeah.
Yep, yep.
And also, you went on to do a lot of keyboard and bass playing, a lot of replays for people.
Yep. I mean, kind of like, you know, I'm not like a virtuoso player, but I'm more like a utility player because I play different instruments and I have strong ears. So I became like the, you know, I became like the fixer. Like, we can't use this sample. So call Anton.
Who else? I know you did some stuff for Biz Markie, but like, who else did you do?
Biz.
That's kind of notable stuff that you played.
Let's see. Well, Puba.
Which Puba, one for Puba? I know you worked with him. I was going to ask you what you did with him because I wasn't sure.
360, Reel to Reel.
That song or the whole album?
That song is basically an impeached loop and my bass.
Wow. And scratches. I didn't know that, man. You the fucking
That's
man.
All.
I ain't know that.
Yeah, 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 yeah. There's just one thing I want to say. The really, 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 real, yo. There's just one thing I want to say. Copy, 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 copy. There's just one thing I want to say. We gon' hit it down like this, y'all know the flavor. There's just one thing I wanna say. Alamo, is you with me? What goes around comes back around again. Stud Doogie, is you with me? What goes around comes back around again. SOS, is you with me? What goes around comes back around again. Yeah, this how we gon' bust it down, y'all. You know the flavor. You know what time is it.
Check one was, Puba left.
Yeah.
Day, he broke out, and I had this whole arrangement for Reel to Reel,
yeah,
with bass, guitar track, and a Rhodes track. It was like I had built this whole track, and Puba comes in the next day and goes, "No, I lose all that. Just keep the bass.
Just keep the bass."
And he was right. And he was right. Yeah.
Usually bust records on getting butt naked. Made for the Benzy. Drive a nigga skinzy, pump the tape, grab your naked with the pool bar frenzy. Come on, honey, thing, don't you try to eject slowdowns. What you say once my joint gets erect? Some try to copy, but they just can't sketch it. Some try to follow, but they just can't catch it with the boom, boom, tap. Yeah, all of that. Look, I'm living fat, me fall off, there be none of that. See, who's the one to flip it? Quick to tell a nigga to zip it, still drink the 40, cause we ain't got time to sip it. Grand Puba got body. Kick some of them, some of those, and some yachty. As dope as they come, suck a single hum. Don't try to step to this, you know your shit is slum. First batter up, well here's the pitch, it's a curve. Second batter up because the first got served. The one who arouses so,
and
a
then, and then like I would walk over, you know, I'd go over to SD50 studio, Dante.
Right.
Dante who, Ross. You know, yeah, we go back forever too. So I'd go over there and just spend a whole night playing. On different projects, different tracks, they'd be like, that's great, let's move on to the next song. So that way, like, I don't even know some of the tracks that I'm on. Like, I know I'm on
the De La stuff?
No, but, like, Hard to Obtain. I know I've got a bass line on Isn't It Blues.
For the 9 box, yo. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, for the 12 block, Hard to Obtain. Yo, yo, peace to the back, yo, love, set it on. Check it.
Uh-oh, I be putting your niggas like Waco, for real, yo. You gonna need more than that, go.
Oogie with the oogie. Mad pounds of fought more than loot in the treasure. Rose out like an over, they witness like Jehovah. I do it just because like that beat does just spins over. Raise up my levels, I get hyper once it's active. Commence to spit the shit to make my niggas hyperactive. My stats, baby, I beat the honest with the fuckers. Don't think I'm ass when I'm blasting. Your homo niggas be friends. One of them boys just gotta get one on like that. With the
funky shit, some killer monkey shit, car, a swift resurrection from the 12th section. I get spins like Marcus next world, like the Jetsons, nigga. Oh, shut up, shots is ripping up in your vest, nigga.
Literally, like a couple of weeks ago, asked Dante about the sessions and, like, do you know where all that stuff ended up?
Yeah.
And he's like, no, man, I'd have to really dig. He's the one who reminded me of the Hard to Obtain track.
Wow.
Because I had totally forgotten. Yeah. And Search's first, you know, Search's solo
back
album.
Back to the Grill Again.
Yep. Yeah. That's me playing organ.
Yeah.
And bass.
Yeah,
that's how Nas got put on. You know, Live at the Barbecue gave him a buzz, but right. It didn't give him a record deal. Right, he was right. Back to the Grill Again that got him signed.
Back to the Grill Again, the Grill Again. 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 Back to the Grill Again.
Church will never stand still. You need a posse the size of the Nazis to attack this. And you're more optimistic than the sounds of blackness. Flip rhymes to rip through the chest cavity, and I keep going and going just like an energizer battery. Flattery will get you nowhere unless it's the Daria, and then it gets you everywhere. Went to the flea market, was in my car parked.
Then, okay, and that, oh, you also worked with Akinelli on Vagina Dinah.
Oh, I did almost that entire album again because there was a Large Proffesor production.
Right.
And that's where Rob Swift came into the picture.
Yeah, and that joint was dope. That Rob Swift Get Busy.
Yep.
Dope.
That album, you know, to me, severely underrated.
No doubt. Very
underrated. You know, Ock didn't do himself any favors as far as his choice of material.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because none of that shit could really be played on the radio.
Right.
But that's one of the hardest records ever.
My vocals sound dynamic when it's placed on track. Me whack, your local mechanic couldn't even fix his mouth to say that. I make a rapper change his occupation and have him selling hot dogs if he ain't saying Nathan. I wait for challengers to pick a day to beef. I'm out of calendar. I knock your ass to the middle of next week. Leaving you outdated. I'm R-rated. Niggas on my dick, they fall off if I was to get castrated. No need to explain. I'm doper than heroin, so just take my name in vain. You can't follow the Ock footmarks. I throw your raps in a shoebox and let the bullshit walk. I straighten up those who be slacking up. In other words, I'm not a film director, so don't come over here acting up.
I think it went underrated because it went under the radar because there were no radio records. I think the true hip hop heads know. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. Yep.
But yeah, it could have went a lot further. It was
some, yeah, if Ock was a little bit smarter about, you know, just a couple of joints.
Yeah.
But, you know, Ock wanted to keep it 100%.
So, and then I think you worked on some stuff with Antoinette, too. Did you work on some of her stuff?
Sure did.
Because that's how I've been looking for you. You know, I guess you wasn't that hard to find, but that's how I found you because... Because
of G-Off.
G-Off, yeah. And I was like, wait a minute. I saw your name. I was like, I've been looking for this dude. Yeah.
Yep. G-Off. And back then, Antoinette and G-Off were being managed by this dude, Jay Ellis,
mm-hmm.
who was like old white music business dude.
Right.
Like, made his name in the 70s. Like, he managed Gloria Gaynor for a while.
Yeah.
Super sleazy, shady kind of dude.
Yeah.
Everybody hated him at Power Play.
Yeah.
And none of the engineers would work with him. And I didn't know him, so, like, you know, they said, you know, nobody else would work with Jay Ellis. Will you do it? I said, well, I'll give it a shot. And then, you know what? Jay was a pain in the ass, but I learned how to manage him.
Right.
You're like, Jay, there's the lounge. That's where you sit. This is the control room. This is where we sit. Right. Yeah. And, you know, it all worked out. And G-Off was a super talented producer already. And I thought Antoinette was badass. I mean, she's one of my favorite female MCs.
I've got her tomorrow. So
awesome. Well, tell her I said what's up.
We'll do that, man.
Yo, G-Off, get a few beds out because they believe. The hyping, now the wiping up the mess I left behind me. I lose myself so they can't find me. behind me. Now the gangster sits at large. You're a private, and I'm a sergeant. So true, it's time to get fresh and follow Antoinette as I do the kick step.
So I got so much stuff on. Talk about sample this.
All right, so I knew this drummer. We played in a couple of bands together, this dude Curtis Watts, and I got him a job at PowerPlay because he needed a gig, and I got him a job at PowerPlay first as an intern and then as an assistant. And, you know, we had time off between sessions, after sessions, and we're in a studio, so Curtis and I just started jamming. I started writing tracks. I was, as I mentioned earlier, I was obsessed with the meters then. So I was basically writing tracks that sounded like the meters.
Right.
And we weren't really trying to get signed or anything else. We were just making music.
Just having fun jamming.
And then it's one night, this girl pokes her head in the studio and she's like, "What's this?" And we're like, you know, just us playing. She's like, "It's dope. Can I write to it?"
Yeah.
We're like, "Please, let me make you a tape." Next week, she comes back with five songs, finished.
Wow.
And we're like, this is unexpected, but really dope.
Yeah.
So we record the vocals. We got five songs. A week later, I'm sitting in Dante Ross's office talking about Puba. And I wasn't trying to get signed either. I just wanted his opinion because Dante is another soul music fanatic.
Right.
So I was like, "Here's, check this out. I want to know what you think." I hand him a cassette, and he listens to it, and the head nod starts. And by the end of it, he's like, "So you want to make a record?" I did not expect this. I swear I was not fishing for a record deal.
Right.
I really just wanted his opinion. And that was his opinion. "You want to make a record?" And I was like, "Bet."
That's crazy.
You know, as soon as he said that, I realized that, you know, yes, I want to make a record. And then we made a record. I mean, we had a deal signed like a month later. You know, I went out and got a lawyer and we negotiated a deal. And of course, there was no band. It was, you know, Curtis on drums and me playing everything else. So all of a sudden, we had to do shows. So I had to put a band together.
Right.
But I'd been, you know, I'd been a musician in New York for a long time by then, so I knew enough. I knew the cats that I wanted to be in my band.
Right.
And as soon as I reached out, it was pretty easy because, you know, when you have a record deal, everybody's like, "Oh yeah, I'm down."
That's crazy.
So from nothing, we put a 9-piece band together, finished the record, came out and went out and did, you know, many shows and some touring. It was, you know, it was really dope. I loved
great
it.
Experience.
I mean, didn't great make record. Any money. Didn't make any money. You know, again, it's like, it's not radio music.
Yeah.
But you know, we're trying to make old soul music.
Right.
And, you know, we weren't the only ones at the time. The Brand New Heavies were rocking at the time. Groups like them and Incognito and even Sade. It was pretty much kind of an underground movement.
Yeah.
You know, we kind of missed it by a few years because literally, you know, a few years later, we got D'Angelo and Maxwell and Michelle and Degocello.
And you know what? I'm glad you brought that up because I was going to say that. It's kind of like y'all gave birth to that style. You know,
yeah.
The whole roads and everything. And I think a lot of people don't, you know, they don't realize that. You know what I'm saying? That, yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. And maybe now people will go back, you know, and see if they can find some of your stuff.
I actually thought about re-releasing it because we actually own the rights and the masters.
Oh, word? Yeah. You should do that, man.
But at the same time, it's like, you know, nobody buys music right now anyway, so... Yeah. You know, I'm not sure what the point would be.
Yeah, I don't know, but it was good music, man. Like I said, I really feel like that.
Actually, not just me. We all put our heart in that record.
Yeah, man, I'm sure good music. So,
thank you.
I know I'm about bouncing around on you a lot, but I want to get everything out before you got to go. So, what about T-Ray?
Well, T-Ray. Really, right around the same time that I was working on the Puba stuff and all that.
And for people T-Ray who don't know, kind of, you know, who T-Ray is.
So T-Ray was this white kid from South Carolina.
I'm going to stop you one more time. I'm sorry, but listen, I got to address the elephant in the room. How many times have you and T-Ray been mistaken for being black?
Well... Especially with a name like Anton, pretty much all the time. So I actually had a standard line that I would say.
Mm.
You know, like I'd get a call for a session from a group or people that didn't know me personally.
Yeah.
And I'd show up at the studio and be like, they'd be like, who the fuck are you? And I'm like, I'm Anton.
You're like,
no, and like, no, Anton's black. And my answer was always, I'm working on it.
Right, you're working on it, yeah.
Which I stole from this jazz musician, Keith Jarrett.
Because
Keith Jarrett actually looks black.
Yeah.
But he's actually Serbian.
Oh, word.
So one night backstage after a concert, Miles Davis was talking to him, and he's like, you got to be black somehow. And then that's when he said, I'm working on it.
Yeah, that's how I feel about you and T-Ray. I got to be black somewhere. Now.
Somewhere. But no, T-Ray started, you know, he was coming up working on tracks for people, and he started using PowerPlay, which is how we met. And we just hit it off because, you know, again, the same obsession with the deep cuts, with the soul music.
Right.
And we started working together more and more, and then we just kind of became a team. You know, it was organic. It wasn't like at any point anybody said, okay, let's like draw paperwork and become a team.
Yeah.
It was totally just by doing it.
So did you do any of the work with Funkdoobiest and, you know,
I did. I did Which Doobie You Be. On the Double X Posse record.
Double X Posse, gonna be able to do it.
Yep, put your boots on.
Yeah.
Yep.
I wonder where them guys at. Double X Posse.
Oh shit, they didn't give me a chance to rock the goddamn mic. Yeah, y'all in the house, I got my boots on. I'm the Brigadier General Mike, Jimmy the Kingpin, 1013, Jimmy Dive, the Joke Fee. We got my man BK in the house, Sugar Ray.
Nah, baby, I'm not gonna be able to do it. I tried to take you serious before when you blew it. You thought that you were slick, dissing me for the next man. But when you heard you had a wife, it ruined your plan. Now you wanna come back and act like it's all right. But I ain't trying to hear it cause you sound real whack. You got it off the first time, but that was the last time. I'll never make the same mistake again and you hook up. No way, no how, your history. So let's keep it real, cause this ain't no mystery. You had it like a queen, living lovely and lovely. Your props had an all-time low, and you collected. I used to treat you good, take you shopping and feed you. But now I'm doing fine, and girlfriend, I don't need you.
No idea, but I did not work on the Artifacts record because okay. Artifacts, they had their own crew and their own team, and T-Ray did that at Soundtracks, okay. Which is a studio in Midtown.
The facts, they still had a dope album, those kind of.
It's a classic.
Yeah.
And T-Ray did every beat on that record, I think.
And you also did some work for the legendary Carlos Santana.
That was, again, because of T-Ray. What happened was, you know, and this is like, people can argue this, mm-hmm. but to me, somewhere in the mid-90s, hip-hop changed drastically.
I'm not going to argue with you about it. Definitely did.
You know, at some point, it went from like this wild creativity to like, let's get on the radio.
Right.
And then everything started sounding the same. And, you know,
cookie cutter shit.
I kind of blame, Puff Daddy for it.
Yeah.
Because he kind of spearheaded it, yeah. Which is funny because I actually met Puff Daddy when he was trying to get into a Father MC session. People were not letting him in because nobody knew who he was.
Yeah.
But even then, you could tell that dude was focused.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one thing you can not take away from him. Dude is focused on the prize. And as hip-hop started changing, both T-Ray and I started not feeling it.
Right.
And T-Ray had management at the time, and they started getting us gigs outside of hip-hop. That's how we ended up doing a Fishbone remix. Wow. We did a Luscious Jackson remix. And that's how Santana happened. Mm-hmm. T-Ray, at some point in the late 90s, T-Ray moved to California.
Okay.
He came out there and fell in love with the place and moved to Malibu. And I was still in New York. I had no intention of moving to California. But then we were getting so much work out there that I spent like half the year out there living out of hotel rooms,
right,
working on projects while, you know, paying rent on a New York City apartment that was sitting empty.
Right, right.
After a couple of years, I was like, all right, I just have to do this. And what happened with Santana is they had a track that the Dust Brothers did,
mm-hmm.
and Santana hated it, didn't want it on the album. So through management, they connected us with their executive production team, and they're like, can you rescue this song? Because we really want it on the album.
Right.
And that's what we did. Right. We kept the vocals, and we kept Carlos's guitar, and everything else got erased and done over.
Touches me most. Good times can put me in fear. I always feel safe when things are bad, so I cannot let you come in. It seems that I thrive in the dark side of things. I always feel alive when the death bell rings. Now you come and you bring out the tears in me. Pain never makes me cry.
Without you, there ain't pressure, but you, at that point, you work with the best of the best, so.
Yeah,
like, how does that feel to get that call
there was
to fix that?
Pressure. Yeah. There was definitely pressure because at the end of each day of work, we made a rough mix and ISDN'd it. Back then, it was the only way to transfer files to Clive Davis in New York.
All right.
And the next morning, he'd call us with his notes.
Okay.
So it was daily pressure.
Yeah.
But also, like so many things, I mean, we knew we were working with a legend,
mm-hmm.
but Carlos Santana hadn't had a hit in like 15, 20 years.
Right.
We didn't think we were like working on a hit album. We just thought it was cool to work with a legend.
Right. You didn't think he was going to bring them back.
No, and then, you know, 6 months later, or 9 months later, we're at the Grammys.
Right.
Which was just crazy.
You know, that was crazy, crazy out there. You live, like I tell a lot of people, man, you live the magical life, man.
It was definitely an interesting
still
one.
Living. Still yep. living it.
Man, still working. Crazy. Not that long ago, did some mixes for Large Proffesor. We're still talking. You know, he was here for South by Southwest last year.
You're in Texas now, yeah.
Yeah, I moved here because I got a studio here with a partner.
Okay.
I got a badass studio. It's called Red Horse Ranch. With a vintage API console, and we still, we got all the Pro Tools and all the modern shit, but we still have a 2-inch tape machine.
That's what's up.
Some vintage microphones. So, you can't really, LA doesn't really have the space to do that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it does, but it's just insanely expensive.
Yeah. That's cool. So, go ahead.
No, so I'm out here now working on projects, working on music all the time. Because that's my life. That's what I do.
It's embedded in your DNA. You have no choice, man.
Pretty much, yeah. It's like, I always tell people who want to get in the music business, it's like, if you're here to make money, there are easier ways of making money.
Right.
The only reason you should be in the music business is because this is what you have to do.
Yeah, have to and love to do.
Yep. Otherwise, there are easier ways to live.
So I want to skip backwards a chunk because sure. I want to, I heard a story about MobbDeep rushing the stage on you and your band and snatching the mics up and y'all having a session.
Yep. Yeah.
So how was that?
That was awesome. I encouraged that kind of thing. We all did.
Yeah.
We were doing a gig at Tramps in New York, which of course is no longer there.
Yeah.
But right in the middle of our set, I see these two little dudes run up and I'm like, yo, it's MobbDeep. and they grabbed mics and we just provided the backing for them to freestyle.
That's what's
up. Crowd went berserk.
Because you worked on actually MobbDeep's first album.
Yeah, I did.
Right.
Again, because of Power Play, you know?
Yeah, because everybody was right there.
Yeah.
It was right there by Queensbridge, so.
Everybody in Queensbridge could walk to Power Play.
Yeah.
And did.
That's crazy, man. Like I said, man, you live a magical life, man. You still living it. You brought hip hop. Like I told you when I contacted you, man, I mean, like, you one of the underrated dudes. I think a lot of people from our school, they know about you, but a lot of them don't. And you, just like I told you, man, sonically, it's like different levels with you. Sonically, You laid the bed of some of the most critical hip hop records in that golden era of hip hop. You know what I'm saying?
Well, thank you. And again, I didn't know that we were making history, but looking back, it seems pretty important.
Yeah, and then that's like I said on the sonic end, just when you're mixing, but then on the production end and all the different playing, like, I mean, just the Kool G Rap Streets of New York alone. I mean, you got to understand what that means to people. You know what I'm saying? That song alone. I mean, I tell people you have these aha moments in hip hop. You know what I'm saying? And the release of that record was an aha moment in hip hop. You know, it was something different. Like you said, nobody really used the sax in that way.
Yep.
The pianos that way. You know what I'm saying?
And also, let's not forget G-Rap's ability to tell a story.
Right. Was next fucking level. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like that. It's just crazy, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why I told you, you're a legend. And people need to know, you know what I'm saying, about you and about the work that you laid down. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you.
And, I mean, from there to, I mean, just like I said, everything you did, you know, like, and sonically, I listened to that stuff, and I know, you know, it was on tape back then, so that's the main difference. But, I mean, it just, those.
You know what? The main difference is always the ears.
Another thing, back to the Rakim and Eric B said, because I heard you in an interview, and I heard you say that no matter how hot you made that 808, Eric B kept raising it up.
That's the truth. It was like, I just stopped after a while, because I knew he was just going to come over and grab the fader and push it up as far as it goes.
Yeah.
Me and Eric B. was cooling at the Palladium, seen an all world cover girl. I said, hey lady, I'm sorry if you're in a rush. Don't let me hold you up or intervene.
And again, it's like, you know, you listen to that record and it works. It's not out of balance.
Yeah, it does. It does. So let me ask you this. Like I said, I don't want to be crunching for time, but
yep.
What's your approach to a mix? Is it different with every song, or like, is there something specific you look for, you know?
If I could use one word, my approach to a mix is organic.
Organic.
I listen to the song. I try to get the essence of it, because the thing about mixing is you're just trying to get the most out of what's already there.
Right.
I don't try to change anything.
Just get the most out of what's there.
Just get the most. So, you know, I mean, I have kind of a routine. I'll start with a kick.
Mm-hmm.
Almost always, you know, and that's common, but, you know, some people start with the vocals when they start a mix.
Right.
I'm not that dude. I start with the kick. I build the drums. I bring in the bass. Then I bring everything else in. When the instrumental is right, then I start bringing in the vocals.
Got you. So, and on the production side, I know you also, you know, like I said, you went from the band thing. I know you worked on some hip house during that era.
Yeah.
What do you like on the production side? What do you enjoy more? Do you enjoy just a simple, you know, chopping up a loop and playing some chords on it? Or do you enjoy where you have more creativity, more sounds, more, you know, experimentation?
These days, if like I'm left to my own devices,
yeah,
I'm making instrumental funk, almost like 70s fusion music.
Yeah, I ran across some of your stuff. It's kind of like psychedelic almost.
Yes, like psychedelic funk fusion, like early 70s, you know, like Herbie Hancock, Headhunters.
Yeah, because I thought I had the wrong person at first. Like, this ain't him. It's like, nah, because you know what? Even though it still has that soul.
Well, what I was going to say is that having been in hip hop for so long, no matter what I do, there's always some kind of element of that.
Yeah.
Present. And it usually has to do with the rhythm section, the drums and the bass.
Right.
You know, I'm always looking to break somebody's neck.
Right, right. And that's, and you mastered that.
Well, thank you.
That's what I told the same thing to, I had Skef Anselm, and I told him the same thing. Mm-hmm. Said, y'all mastered that neck snap and snare. You know what I'm saying?
That's what I always go for.
Yep. You broke a lot of necks. That bounce, man. bounce.
Right on, man.
That's what's up, man. Well, like I said, man, I appreciate you, man, and I appreciate your time.
No, thank you. Thank you for having me on, and, you know, I look forward to hearing it.
No doubt. No doubt, man. And like I said, once again, man, thanks for your contributions to hip-hop, man. You definitely pushed the culture forward, you know what I'm saying? And I'm sure you still are. I'm sure it's still more to come. There's a lot of stuff I didn't go over with you, but we'll probably get a part two, man. But until then,
gotcha.
Peace, man. All right. Live life lucid, man. I'll be in touch.
Right on. Thank you.
All right.
Take care.
Later.